Most tsunami are generated by geological processes, and most of those are earthquakes, with a fault line moving and moving a large amount of water above it. But it can also be a submarine landslide, or a volcanic eruption, or even a landslide going into the ocean. And in very rare occasions, even an asteroid hitting the ocean. Faults on the other side of the Pacific, for example in Chile, or especially Peru, or even North America, Alaska, Japan, etc., right around the Ring of Fire, can also send tsunami our way. In those cases, we're not going to feel the earthquake, but we have sensors and we're part of the Pacific Tsunami Warning System, so we're going to get warning, probably 10 or more hours of warning ahead of time that there's been an earthquake and probably that a tsunami's been generated, and our official emergency management systems will warn you that that tsunami's coming and what you should do. We think about tsunami sources in terms of local, regional and distant sources. Local sources are those ones where the tsunami's got less than an hour to get here. In those cases, the earthquake will be your only warning. Because if you're really close to the fault, the tsunami could arrive within minutes, it's important to not wait for anything. Leave immediately, head to higher ground or inland, and stay away for many hours. Stay away until you get the official all clear. Waves can keep coming for hours, or even tens of hours from a distant source, and you won't know when they're over. All of New Zealand's coastline is at risk from tsunami, but some areas are at risk from bigger or more frequent events than others. Especially the east coast and the east coast of the North Island between Wellington and East Cape faces one of these big subduction zone faults. Tsunami from these largest faults are similar to what we saw in Japan in 2011 and the Indian Ocean in 2004. In these largest subduction zone earthquake and tsunami, how far would we need to go inland to get to safety? Well, I'm going to show you. You need to go uphill or inland, and we've got a road behind me that I can walk up and show you about how high you need to get in those worst cases. So by the time we're up here, we're about 30 or a bit more than 30 meters above sea level. It gives you some idea of how high you need to get to if you're right at the coast. So the Wellington South Coast communities have decided to paint a blue line at about the level that the largest tsunamis can get to across their roads. It's worth noting that these are just a Wellington initiative at the moment, so you're not going to see these around the rest of the country. Elsewhere you need to be looking for evacuation maps. This information board down here at the park in Island Bay shows what those evacuation maps look like. You can see a series of red, orange and yellow zones that can be used, especially in official warnings, to tell us what areas, maybe just the red foreshore or the orange or yellow zones, that need to be evacuated during an official warning. So that might be a warning coming from Peru or Samoa or somewhere far enough away that we can give an official warning. The key message is, if there is time for an official warning, they'll tell you which zone to evacuate. But if you feel a large earthquake, longer than a minute or too strong to stand up and easily, you need to evacuate all of the zones immediately. You don't know how big it's going to be, and those earthquake felt sources are close by potentially, so you need to evacuate without waiting for anything. You will not get an official warning after a large earthquake. Head uphill or inland, every meter you go, the safer you get.